Where's my assistant manager? The shout boomed from the workshop, sailing over 10 looters having a fight over a gold chain, deafening 3 grots who were operating heavy machinery. And still managing to be heard by an orc stood atop a makeshift catwalk overlooking a bay of tanks that were being dissected by numerous groups of grots and snotlings. His hands on the rails as he watched them go about their work. As the sound reached his wax-filled ears, his head dropped with a sigh. Zog. Boss wants me. With that, he slowly walked down the walkway, sliding down a ladder as he dusted off his hands. An assistant manager's work was never done. Calm down, boss. The offending orc was quickly backhanded by a metallic hand, crushing his nose into his face. Don't tell me Tay calm down. Yasquig. Can't be letting customers think in Wes some sort of naff. Namby pamby. Shorty, second rate supplies can we? Kagob Gra truck puts the customer first. The massive big mech roared, upturning a workbench and sending the grots sitting on it flying across the room and in the direction of several sharp pieces of operating power tools. Yar wanted to see me, boss. The big mech turned around. In the doorway stood Lefty, his missing assistant manager. Kagob's pig-like nostrils flared as his eyes came to rest on him. Lefty. Jerin there. Now Lefty did as he was told, stepping over the dismembered remains of several grots as he made his way over to the furious big mech. Barely getting within reach before a massive arm picked him up by the scruff of his neck. He made no effort to struggle as he was helplessly suspended in the air, dragged over to the garage next door. 3 looters dropped their tools as Kagob stormed in, pulling their goggles off as they stared at him in open-mouthed shock. You lot. Out. Now, the huge orc certainly didn't have to repeat himself, all 3 of the greenskins quickly gathering as many of their bits as they could and hurriedly exiting. Satisfied that they were now alone, Kagob thrust Lefty face first into a war truck. What's this, Lefty? Lefty peeled his face back from the sudden impact, rubbing his head. It's a truck, boss. Re-i-i-i-i-t. The big mech nodded. Content. And what color is it? Red. Kagob launched him halfway across the room, his fall cushioned only by falling back first on a V12 engine. Yes. Red. The big mech yelled, swatting a row of bikes down in fury. Warbus Brain Squisher asked for blue. What are you playing at? Lefty frowned, cocking his head as he slowly recognized the vehicle. Boss, you got my boys to paint this red all personal like only the other day. The mech paused, tapping the front bumper of a buggy that made up his jawplet. Did I? Lefty slowly got to his feet, dusting himself off with a sigh. Boss, did yous forget you was colorblind again? Kagob snarled, kicking open the door as he marched off, mumbling to himself. Was just testing you, that's all. Lefty looked at the mess all around him, shaking his head as a group of orcs slowly made their way into the room to see if they could get back to work yet without being crushed. Oh aye, you lot. Lefty pointed to them each in turn. Clear this mess up. S like a squig's tie air. They grunted and quickly went about picking up all the bits and pieces scattered about the garage. Lefty looking on with his arms folded, supervising. And paint this fucking blue when you're done. I got to do everything round there myself. An assistant manager's work was never done. Lefty marched down one of the corridors of the ship, a large retinue of grots and orcs all gathered around him as he gave them instructions on the move. You lot. Take dat off of dat and put it on dat instead. Boss wants the engine to sound like a squiggoth with a sore ass. Why got dat? The orcs nodded with a grunt, heading off to their work. Excuse us. A group of around 6 grots carrying a missile weaved through the group in the hallway, very nearly tripping over an exposed pipe but managing to keep upright. Oh I. Lefty spat, raising his pointy stick at them. Yow's lot dropped that and the next war buggy on assembly lines. Jerin grot skin seats. Ya got that? Yes. Yes. Yes, all of them cried, hurrying along to the vehicle that was no doubt waiting to be reloaded. Lefty sighed. When he got his head removed by a thunderhammer one day, Lefty was scooped up by the brilliant inventor Kagob Gratruck, and eccentric even by Widboy standards. With the big mech's natural ability with machinery and weapons, and left his unnatural gifts of business sense and organization, the two began gathering Lutus and Gretchen who were looking for a good set of teeth all over the universe. At first, their projects were small but expensive. Kagob thought it was stupid to charge so much money for small vehicles and services, but Lefty, as a business orc, knew that others would think they were of better quality because of it, and while neither of them knew it, because other orcs believed it, it was true. Relatively soon, warbuses from all over started bringing across orders for all manner of things, from combated looted Imperial tanks and aircraft, to shoot a SUD would bring a tear to the eye of the stuffiest flash jet, all the way to personal gold-plated attack bikes and walkopters. Quite soon, they found that they had to begin putting out looting squads all over the place, quickly gaining a reputation for being where an orc could always sell his best bits. Then they began to run out of room. This situation was quickly solved when a space hulk by the name of Light of Man was discovered by several different groups of orcs. All engaging in one huge war over who got to be the first to loot it, the Jenna Stealers on board were promptly wiped out in the ensuing battles, and Lefty saw an opportunity in it, having a mobile workstation from which they should deliver their goods by hand while still continuing their work with enough storage capacity to fit even the grandest products of Cargob's imagination, was simply too much to pass up. And so when a winner finally emerged, they bought it outright from underneath him, his levels of equipment and boys completely devastated, but the Warbus himself satisfied that he had a good fight. And won, and set about making it space travel worthy. Whether the Light of Man was once etched, now were rusty metal beams hammered into the words "The Chop Shop." With all the teeth he had ever dreamed of and the protection of someone no Warbus wanted to snub in case he stopped selling to them, life was good. However, he was always the first to hear about it when something went awry, often even when he was nowhere near the problem on the kilometer-long ship they spent their time hurtling across space inside. But the other bad part about being a brain boy, an orc that actually had some semblance of intelligence, was that you found yourself having to think for everyone else. Lefty turned around, eyeing the orc that had tapped him on the shoulder, his jaw gradually dropping as he did so. The green skin stood there, with what was very clearly a brake lever with the skin from a human's arm as the cover. Add this in me and all day. Do you know what it's for? As if to answer the question, the roar of an engine started up behind them. Lefty span around. Don't drive that, ya stupid jit, but it was too late. Flashboy was an orc obsessed with speed. No matter how fast Cargob could make something go, Flashboy always wanted it to go faster. Therefore, Cargob had set himself the personal challenge of finding something fast enough for Flashboy's tastes, taking him under his wing as his private test pilot. A private test pilot that was now a stain on the hull wall. Well, Zog, Lefty stood there a moment, steadily realizing that he would get the blame for this, before vaulting up onto the top of a half-gutted Lemon Russ. The smoldering wreckage of Flashboy's vehicle only briefly registered with the rest of the orcs before they turned back to Lefty, unimpressed. Alright boys, listen up, and listen up good. The few that were still blaring their power tools were slapped upside the head by those standing near them, turning them off with a buzz and looking towards Lefty expectantly. Lately, there's been some productivity issues and all that. Well, that stops today. The crowd mostly cocked their heads at him. From now on, you wants a break to muck about, it's coming out of your pay. Anyone wanna argue about it, come see me and I's can start paying you with your own teeth when I crump ya and take him out of your face. He tapped his poking stick on the side of the tank. A grot recoiling in horror as the bane of his kind almost grazed its face. Always clear, boys. There was a murmur of mild agreement, answered with Lefty tapping the side of the tank again. The boss may be half deaf, but I ain't, and I can tells you lot that wasn't loud enough. The chant was louder now, if much more artificial. Yeah, assistant manager, sir. Ask any of the orcs on the floor and they would say Lefty was one of the best bosses they ever had, probably before getting cut in half by Cargob for using the word boss for anyone else but him. But for all intents and purposes, it was true. Cargob was an eccentric, and one that only Lefty truly understood. He was massive and deadly. As well as brilliant and creative, he was also poor at managing his resources and would have been in debt to 1,000 angry Warbosses right now had Lefty not been balancing the books. As such, this had been the most stable income many of these orcs had ever had, as well as easy access to the best gear in the galaxy again, assuming Cargob wouldn't kill them first for touching his things. The only thing they lacked in abundance was fighting, which was for the most part easily solved by a good mug of fungus beer and a brawl down in the fight and pits down at the ship's bottom. Occasionally though, Lefty had to crack the whip and get them back on task. They were orcs, after all, and all orcs respected at the end of the day was the biggest bloke with the biggest gob. Lefty certainly had one of those requirements. Now, what would he do about the Flashboy situation? Cargob would have gone on forever trying to make things fast enough, never realizing that the brilliant red finish he was putting onto the contraption was near enough always turning out pink. He stood, tapping his chin with his poking stick, not even noticing the huge and hulking form that had approached him. Oh aye, you're in me bloody light, you are. Lefty growled, only realizing how big something would have to be to tower over him after the fact. Wes closed fair orders at the minute. The Warbus laughed, clacking his power claw as he did. After little ol' scumfang come all this way, I don't think you are. See, I'm here for something special like. Lefty tried to gain his recomposure. Listen, I know you probably think you wantin' something dead good and all that, but let's just skip this bit and you can go pick a bike from the line over. His voice trailed off. More and more orcs wearing the huge figure's colors filtering into the factory floor, right up until they outnumbered the workers. There must have been 300 of the Warbus's boys with him, all, oddly enough, carrying large sacks. In unison, every single orc dumped their sacks down onto the floor. Within no time at all, the entire floor was absolutely covered in teeth. I am here for one of your zoggin bikes, Yasquig. The Warbus chuckled again, picking Lefty up by his head. I'm here to have the best thing an orc can get to show Gork and Bork his respects while stomping all the things he can see. All scumfling there, he pulled Lefty closer, his claw tightening slightly on his head. I want a mega gargant. He wants a what? Cargob nearly dropped the massive wrench he was using to take off a predator tank's main cannon. The grots below him rather grateful for his mechanical grip. Lefty shrugged weakly. I know, that's what I said. It's not like we're short on orders or anything. Loads of teeth to go round already. This scumfling as they played the big fancy bad moon and bringing all his teeth. Probably broke now, he snorted, tossing a bolt into the air and catching it. The big mech pondered for a moment, frowning. I don't like that look in your eye, boss. Quiet, your grot. Eyes thinking. A moment of uncomfortable silence passed between them, broken only by the occasional death scream of a grot that didn't notice the faulty positioning of the automatic saw blade beneath the workbench. Finally, Cargob nodded to himself. I say we do it. Lefty's eyebrows went all the way up his bald green head. What? Boo, but, big boss. Wes got loads of orders that we can only just about fill now. We ain't got time for something that big. Plus Wes gotta get all the really good bits and gubbins to Jever, and a manpower, and a experts. Well, suppose y'all's better get round to doing all of that. Haven't you, assistant manager? They stared at each other, Lefty relenting. Yes, boss, and be quick about it. While he couldn't promise to be quick, Lefty could follow up on everything else. It would be the best mega gargant ever, or his name was not Lefty Tennant. Scene 1. Oh aye, Gromgark, you know what them Yumi's called ear shooters, Orgut said, shifting the truck into the 13th gear. Green death vehicles generally started somewhere along the 10th gear or so, since Warbus and Gork hated having to accelerate before shifting into the higher gears. Nah, and why should I give a zog? Gromgark replied, picking his teeth with a bone he found in the corner of the truck's passenger compartment. Cause I say so, ya half jit. Days called ear shooters boltus. Can ya believe that Orgut's turned the wheel sharply to the left, the entire truck cringing. I tell ya, I been fighting Yumi's since I was a Ouijit and I never heard no shooter make that kinda noise. It just don't make no sense. Gromgark sighed, threw his toothpicking bone to the side and leaned his back against the truck's side. What about rockets? They don't make no rocket sound neither. They just kinda make this FFFSSHHH sound and then they explode. And Snazgun's jazz sound like a couple of shooters strapped to each other. Orgut stroked his chin, thinking really hard about what Gromgark just said. It was true that sometimes orcs named their weapons after what they did and not what they sounded like, but what was a bolt? But after a few seconds of hard thinking, his head started to hurt like that one time he got into a headbutting contest with a Siborg Hugsnake. So he did what any self-respecting orc would do and pretended the conversation never happened. You hear what them screaming Yumi's with them fancy ats do? All what's ats told me after we fought this bugs on Huxai. What? Ya mean like that Yumi what crumped or snit? The one with the glowing chopper, Gromgark answered, yawning loudly. He looked like he would have fallen asleep long ago if it hadn't been for the fact that the truck was constantly bouncing back and forth, probably due to the breakneck speed it was moving at. Yup, that's the one. So what's that? He tells me the Yumi's got this thing called Erezi, right? Erezi? Sounds weird, don't have to tell me. See, Erezi's dear word fair anarchy. Some jit tries to run away from a proper fight, it's Erezi. Some jit tries to act like he's the boss when he's small and weedy and don't have no decker either, it's Erezi. So the Yumi with the fancy at, he's the Yumi knob. Anyone give I am lip and he just puts a slug in his head. Zoginorki, it is. and Kazumi's are all the same size. He wears Durat so the others can seize the boss. What about if he loses Durat, then? Or what if the other lads can't see IM cause he's too small? How they gonna know who's the boss? They shoulder give IM special shoes what makes IM look bigger. Dat will the bean the schmott fein they do. They think they have beaten us lot. I think it's safe they say they ain't schmott, August replied, suddenly slamming his massive green foot on the brakes. The truck stopped surprisingly fast, tires screeching. The sudden stop threw the unprepared Gromgark headfirst into the passenger seat, a loud crunching sound echoing through the truck as the orc's skull hit the metal. What does Og do ya think ya doing? Ya grot lover Gromgark shouted furiously, drawing the knife he had made from a Hormagon's talon during the fighting on Huxus Prime. Orgots just turned around, a big grin revealing rows of gold-plated, crooked fangs. Weezer. Gromgark looked at Orgots for a second, and then started smiling too. Rising to his feet, he unholstered his slugger and cocked it. Let's rock. Scene 2. Yeah, sure ya can take carrier dis, Gromgark whispered, pressing his gigantic green ear against the door to listen for any sign that they had been discovered. Fed a last time, I get it, Orgots replied, obviously annoyed. He held a massive shooter in his hands, consisting of what looked like three shotguns that had been welded together and supplied with an almost comically oversized sighting mechanism. I just keep an eye on the gits, and if any of them try to do something weird, I blast them, and ya let me do the talking. Right, and I'll let you do the talking. The boss just want what they took. The last thing we need is scumpler bullin' about how we're unfair fair taking what belongs to the looters fair and square and crumpin' his boys and Mork knows what. It wasn't very common for orcs to want to settle conflicts peacefully, but things had been a bit uneasy in the clan lately. And Gromgok sure didn't fancy waking up with a bomb squig shoved down his pants. Like it or not, they would have to do this without killing anyone. I'm an ex-commando, ya know, Orgots muttered under his breath. I think I know a bit more about sneaking up on gits than some knob with more teeth than schmots. What's that, Gromgark said, raising his left eyebrow. Nothing. Let's just do this right and proper. Ya got that right. With a roar, Gromgark kicked the door in, showering the shocked looters inside with splinters. Before they had much time to react, Orgots had fired several shots into the roof of the hut, making the surprised orcs freeze in their tracks. Right, I see any of you lot reach fair as much as a snotling zapper and my buddy Errol blast dem stupid gubbins clean off your faces, Gromgark roared, pointing his slugger straight at the closest orc. Now, how's about you lot tell me where the gubbins are? The looter just gave Gromgark a stupid look, well, stupid for an orc, at least, and looked at one of the others. Oh I'm over here. Squig brains, Gromgark shouted, the looter quickly turning his head to stare at the gun being pointed at him. Tell me where the gubbins are and I won't have to shoot your orky bits off. What gubbins, the looter stuttered, staring at the floor. Oh I, look at me. This is the last time I'm gonna tell ya before I start shooting. Where's the gubbins? I dunno what gubbins why ye talking about. Taking two steps forward, Gromgark stood a few inches from the looter. Since he was at least two heads taller, he had to tilt his head down in order to look him in the eye. Who's the boss round these parts? What? I said who's the boss round these parts? Zogface Gromgark accentuated his question by putting his slugger against the looter's temple, cocking it slowly. Deed that be Warbus in Gork. That's right. Looks like you're not completely zogged in the bed. Now, can ya tell me what Warbus in Gork looks like? What? Without warning, Gromgark smacked the looter in the face with the butt of his slugger, knocking him to the floor. The other two looters started to run toward him, but were stopped by a warning shot from Orgots' shooter. Don't say what again, fain guess I'll jit ugly if ya do, Gromgark said, pulling the looter to his feet by his right ear. I'll ask again, what does Warbus in Gork look like? Well, he's big, real big, like a dread. And he's got all these shiny metal gubbins in his head what makes these sounds like them giant bugs in the swamp, the frightened looter responded, rubbing his head with fingers like green sausages. Right. And does he look like a grot? What? The sound of bone cracking could be heard as Gromgark hit the looter again, this time hard enough to draw blood. The looter lay sprawled on his back, looking up at Gromgark, who was starting to look extremely angry. I told ya, didn't I? Dunge it up. Does Warbus in Gork look like a grot to you? And no, he doesn't look like a grot to me, the looter exclaimed frantically, blood running down his forehead and into his eyes in a steady stream. And why do Yazog I am like he's a grot? Why do y'all steal his gubbins and hide them away? Did y'all really think he wouldn't find ya? Now tell me where the gubbins are, for I lose my patience. At this point one of the other looters raised his hand and opened his mouth. I can tea. Before he had a chance to finish his sentence, there was a loud bang as half his head was blown clean off, and the looter fell backwards. A fountain of blood gushing from what remained attached to his neck. Oops, Orgut exclaimed, his shooter still smoking. With a shout, the looter that had been standing next to the dead one threw himself against Orgut's, only to end up with a chest full of bullets the size of a man's fist. He fell to the ground face first like a big green sack of squig. Fed a lovia gork, Gromgark muttered, shooting the loot on the floor right between his eyes. Why does Zog did Yar have to do that? Yar saw I am. E move. Yar told me that if an Eone dem moved, I was supposed to last him, and I did. Orguts shouted back, waving his shooter around like a giant finger. Zog in commandus, think ye Gazgor, and dis is Armageddon. Why the boss done jez jit riddled a lot o Yar? I'll never understand. Holstering his slugger and tucking his knife back into his belt, Gromgark stared at the mess Orguts had caused. It wouldn't be long until someone came to find out what all the noise was about and if there was something to loot. Let's jez find the gubbins and jit out for Yar can't jit us into any more trouble. I told Yar, it wasn't my fault. He shouldn't even move like that. You told him to jez stand still. What if he was gonna reach for a blaster or something? Orguts exclaimed, sounding quite ashamed of himself. He was gonna tell us where the gubbins were, that's what he was gonna do, squig brains. And Yar zogged it. Now help me look, for we both end up on the wrong side of a diff blaster. Gromgok growled and started to dig through one of the various piles of junk scattered throughout the hut. I didn't think there was no right side to a diff blaster, Orguts said and scratched his head. He never was very good at this whole thinking thing. Ain't you a Zoggin Orcyclopedia? Now stop mucking about and find those gubbins, will ya? Scene 3. Ya really are a stupid Zog. Ya know dat, Orguts Gromgark said between bites of his roasted squig, spraying bits and pieces of food across the table with every word. Fed a last time, I'm sorry. How was I supposed to know he wasn't pulling a blast on ya? Orguts replied, throwing his plate right across the room in frustration. I was thinking about Protect and Yar, and this is the thanks I get? Zoggin great. Protection? Dat ain't nothing compared to the protection we're gonna need now, Grot Zogger. I told Yar, those looters was scumplets boys, and right about now, he's gotta be wondering who it was dat crumped him. And when he finds out, us to reproper Zogged, what makes Yar think they'll find out it was us? Dear is to be hundreds of orcs what colder crumped him. Orguts made a sweeping gesture with his left arm to hammer his point home. Outside the dining hut, hundreds of green shapes were busy fighting, eating and stealing. Let's think about this fair a while, then. Scumpler comes fair as stolen gubbins. When he gets deer, he finds his boys dead and the gubbins re-gone. So he starts to think, just like what we're doing now. He knows the boss wants his gubbins back. And when the boss has a problem, who does he get a fix it? Gromgark pointed a shiny metal finger at Orguts, who seemed to think about it hard for a few seconds before suddenly lighting up. That's us. When the boss has a problem, as Lord Fixit, he exclaimed, excited that he had solved the riddle. That's right. And if a Zog brain like you can figure it out, then Scumplet can too. He's dead cunning. That's a new grot. We're Zogged, to both of us. So's we best get those gubbins to the boss, then. Even Scumplet ain't stupid enough to take the boss on, Orguts said in a nonchalant tone, taking another bite of his snotling on a stick. What makes ya think I haven't tried that already? If it was that easy, that would have been the first thing we did. I ain't heard from the boss since for the mission. So's what we got to do is find a safe place for the gubbins and then try to keep living till we can drop em off. Alright, I think I know a guy, Orguts replied, burping loudly to show the waiter that he didn't have to bring any more food to the table. He's a grot, but he owes me. Saved his green ass when we was fighting them pointy ears. Got some kind of bet in a perishing down by the pits. This is your last chance, y'all know. Zog this up and y'all won't have to wait for Scumplet's boys take crump ya, Gromgark said as he stood up. I just got something to take care of first. Pulling out his slugger and cocking it, Gromgok walked toward the cooking fires in the back of the dining hut, finding a grot in a crude chef's hat standing by a large pot. He stooped over and tapped it on the shoulder. The grot quickly spun around and looked at the knob with a frightened expression on its face. You the cook? Gromgark asked. The grot nodded nervously. I jez wanted to tell ya dis air was the best zoggin squig guy vitron. The knob continued, the grot breathing a sigh of relief. A moment later, there was a loud bang, the grot chef falling backwards into the cooking fire, clutching its chest. Watcha do dat for all got sosked as they hurriedly left the dining hut and headed for their truck. Well, the way I sees it, dat dear grot had cooked the perfect squig. And a weedy grot like I am ain't gonna do nothing better than dat ever again. He's gonna spend the rest of his life trying to live up to dat dear roasted squig what I jez ate. I was jez sparing I am the trouble. Yeah crazy, ya know dat, right? Zoggin crazy is what you are, Orguts muttered as he unlocked the door and sat down in the driver's seat of the truck. Enough with the introductions, Gromgark yelled, slamming his massive green fist into the counter, which barely reached his kneecaps. We jez need ya to take carry a dis air box till we jit back. I don't care about who the lot of ya are or what ya did to earn dat dear glowy gubbin ya got on the wall. The grot with the apron oddly enough didn't respond with fear, like most other Gretchen. Instead he just continued polishing the metal mug he held in his hand with a dirty old rag. He's jez a bit angry cause the last job didn't go well. He's only dem perfectionists, ya see, Orgut said apologetically, giving the grot a friendly pat on its tiny shoulder. Well, we best get going. We's got places to be, and you's got your business to take care of. Jez hold on to dat dear box till we jit back, alright? The two orcs left the gabbling hole, Gromgok chewing on a large piece of bone he had taken from one of the grots earlier. Watch your acting like a huge zog fair. De grots jez doing us a favor, Orguts asked, obviously annoyed by his companion's behavior. Cuz we's both gonna jit crumped, dat's why. We're zogged, yakin unnerstand dat, right? Proper zog, Gromgok shouted back, biting the bone in half. He threw the piece he still held in his hand as far as he could, screaming curses as he did. Scumplet's boys'll get us, and when they do, he's gonna make us wish we ain't never even heard of those gubbins. The only chance we got is to hide the gubbins and Obi wants them more than he wants us crumped. Yeah, jez ben negutif, Orgut said reassuringly as he entered the truck. What's Scumplet gonna do? How about break into the truck? A voice said from the passenger compartment in the back. Oddly enough, it didn't really sound like Gromgark usually did. Break into the truck, dat's a good one. And how's he gonna do dat? Orguts laughed, before everything turned black and his head hit the steering wheel with a loud thud. When they woke up, both Gromgark and Orguts found themselves chained to a pair of solid metal chairs, which in turn were bolted to the floor. In front of them stood a rather short mech boy with his entire lower jaw replaced by a metal plate with jagged teeth. I bet ye're wondering what ye're doing there, right? Well, I'll tell ya, if ye're willing to listen for a while, the mech said, scratching his forehead with one of the talons on his power claw. I'm Scumplet, and I think you two boys are something what belongs to me. Orguts opened his mouth to say something, but before he could get as much as a word out, he was struck from behind with what felt like a very large and very heavy blunt object. Yeah, gonna listen when I'm talking, boys, Scumplet said, waving a finger in Orguts's face as if cautioning a small child. As I said, I think ya are they something what belongs to me. I also think you two zogs crumped my boys back in dat hut, and if dis something I hate, it's having some good fun. I think boys want fancy demselves gazgakil thraka running about and messing with me. Scumper took a step forward, standing right in front of Gromgark. He grabbed him by the throat with his power claw and slowly started to squeeze. So I figure you two lads owe me an explanation, and be quick about it. We ain't done nothing, Gromgark managed to spit out, despite the grip around his throat hardening with every second. That right? Well then, I guess I was wrong, Scumplet said in a mocking tone, letting go of Gromgok's neck and stepping away. But just to be sure, I'm gonna leave the two of you with Drogair. An orc smeared with black war paint stepped out from behind Orgut and Gromgark, holding a large metal pipe in one of his hands. Yasi, Drog used to hang out with the blood axes, he did. Bunch of sneaky fellas, dose blood axes. Teach dear commanders all kinds of ways to hurt others, even green fellas like the two of you. I jez figure I'll leave I am with the two of you, see if he can make sure ya don't have what belongs to me. Dat sounds proper, don't it? And with that, Scumplet left the room, leaving the two bound orcs with the smiling Drog, who was busy practicing swing with his pipe in the air. If you's lot done want to end up like little green flecks on the ground, ya better start talking. Scumplet might let ya jez die with your orkiness left, Drog said, swinging the pipe mere inches from Gromgok's face. Goes Ogre Squig, Grotlo the Wargutz replied, spitting on the floor. I think I'll start by zogging the lot of you first, Drog replied, lifting the pipe high above his head. An orc wag lands on a desolate Necron Tomboulot, and the soulless automatons quickly arise to eradicate the infestation. Every single one of the boys is vaporized, and sterilization fields are activated that kill off even the spores. But through mutation and sheer luck, one spore grows so quickly that it escapes the sterilizing field. A single orc is born. He acquires a chopper and pistol from the ruins of the orc's encampment, but there aren't any boys to be found. The orc looks about uncertainly, then smiles and with a tentative wayag runs off in a random direction. The boys left without him, so he'll just have to track them down. He wanders the dusty wastes for weeks, once he sees smoke, but it turns out to be the remnants of some spill fuel containers. He plays with the fire for a while, but moves on. After all, the real fun will be when he catches up with the boys. Then, to his joy, he finds one of the entrances to the tombs. Down in the vaults, he gazes across row after row of inert Necron warriors. He runs through the halls for a while, roaring and firing his shooter, trying to liven the place up a little. Eventually he walks over and punches one of the warriors in the shoulder. It simply tips over. The tomb remains inert. Since he's the biggest, the orc figures it's his job to whip these funny looking boys into shape. He gathers a bunch of them together in a pile, then stacks a few more to form a nearby podium. Standing on it, the orc gives a rousing speech about how this is a sorry lot but he'll get them ship-shaped soon enough. He tries all sort of things to get a wag going. Insults, violence, praise and flattery. He tries hobbling around on folded knees, thinking that if he's smaller someone else might go and do a better job of starting a wag. Eventually he goes up on the surface again. He heads off and after much searching manages to find the camp. Nothing there has changed. He grabs up as much Daka and Chopper as he can carry and hauls it with him as he spends several weeks looking until he finds the tomb entrance again. Staggering over to where all his boys are, he dumps the huge assortment of weaponry down and looks up hopefully. The moment stretches out as he stands there, looking on with a tentative smile. Eventually he starts picking up choice bits of weaponry and offering them to the Necron warriors. None show any signs of interest. He tries fitting in for a little while, by standing in the same posture and not moving. He pretends to leave and then sneaks back and peeks around the corner to see if any of the Necrons move. He just wants to fight with somebody, just once. He wants to get shot up, to ride shotgun, hooting and hollering. He wants to meet a wit boy or a knob or a doc or Big Mech. He wants to chant and pound the ground in unison with a massive crowd, to sail through the stars to a new world, to play catch with another orc using Gretchen. Just once. He wants to hear somebody call him something. Just one time. Then he'd have a name. He wishes he knew why the boys left him behind. He knows he'll find them, though, someday. OI, boss, communications knob Zoom Orc shouted, peering out of the scanner window. I told ya, I'm the captain when we're on disc hill cruiser Captain Jam ST Cork. Sorry boss, but, boss, where's getting shot up? Cork shot to his feet, his power claw suddenly crackling with energy. You what? Demkili what's it, the metal gits. Tyranids are helpful orc supplied from somewhere nearby. No, you thick gits. The Necrons, days on the starboard bow. Captain Cork pointed to the knob manning the weapons station, a series of tubes leading back to the various gunner stations studded along the length of the cruiser. Fire all the guns. Kill them gits good. But boss, the knob replied. Wes already shooting. Tell the boys to shoot at the metal jits ship. Right you are, boss the knob replied, suddenly enlightened by his captain's masterful thinking. Whiz we all shout in one of the boys asked as the turrets along the length of the ship suddenly blasted into life. Dears no sound in space, another boy replied. So ya got stay shout louder so we can hear each other. Zog it all, it ain't working the shooting abroad, smashing at his crude console in frustration. Cork spun and selected one of his boys at random. You, Yajit, get me the mech boy he shouted. The boy nodded, then turned and roared down the corridor. Oh I, big mech boy Scotty. Captain wants to talk to ya. There was a slight pause. Then, what is it? Boz came echoing up from the engine bays. I needs more Daka and more power to the engines. And more chopper, if ya can do that, Cork roared. He needs more. The intervening orc began to shout, before Cork's big shooter riddled him with bullets that may or may not have been fired by orc psychic powers. Depending on whether you believe certain parts of the fluff or not. But I digress. I can hear I am, so he can hear me. Yard aft jit Cork yelled, more dacker and power. Boss Scotty yelled, yow's crazy, boss. I can't do that. Sure ya can, Cork roared as the Necron weapons began tearing the cruiser apart. Just reverse the polar orb of the warp drive, then stick a wit boy in the torpedo tube. There was a long pause. Certain parts of the ship, mostly armor plates, weapons turrets and other ship components that weren't actually connected to anything vital like an engine or life support, started to dissolve. That's just crazy enough to work, boss. I'll try that. A few minutes later, the screaming wit boy was catapulted out of the launch tube, tied to a torpedo. The orcs of the kill cruiser Octoprize cheered as the warhead smashed into the Necron scout ship and exploded with psychic energy, just before the warp engines imploded. The two energy fields ripped into each other. 288 years later, the crew found themselves clinging to various parts of the ship as it materialized in the atmosphere of an Imperial world. Or, Zogadul Cork yelled, now we's on the ground again. Not yet, Captain Nobzulok yelled over the roaring wind as they plummeted towards the planet. Wes still fallen. We're off the ship now, I'm boss again, Cork admonished him, giving him a backhand with his power claw. The knob went flying off with a scream. Alright you gits, listen up. I think I see a shipyard down there. So once Wes hit the ground, Wes gonna form a huge wire and go get another ship, right? The orcs responded enthusiastically. Alright then. Cork nodded as the ground rushed towards them, possibly powered maybe by orcish psychic energy. Perhaps the various chunks of the ship sprouted parachutes, retro thrusters and other lethal fall aborting devices. On the ground, the PDF were scrambling their defenses as the entire crew of the Octoprize, all 10,000 of them, plummeted towards the ground. Alright jits, Warbus Captain Jam ST, Cork roared, readying his shooter. Set Daka to-
So I hope you guys could understand the orky editing for the voice. I haven't done anything like that in a while, so can only hope you guys enjoyed it for the most part. But no, I felt so bad for that poor boy stuck on a tomb world with nothing to fight. Say what you will about orcs, but they are the only race in 40k that actually enjoy what they do. At least they are having fun, and I love that Pulp Fiction crossover was great fun now. But no, if you guys have any orc stories I should cover, let us know down below. The Death Watch has been on my list of things to do forever, but it's so big I don't want to start something that big without finishing Shadowrun in the cold shoulder, but sure, see what happens. As always, be sure to subscribe for more and check out the Discord, I think it's pretty good. If you haven't already, check out my Redbubble portfolio, you might just find something you like.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services! It's time to stop!